a performance-based system of conditional acceptance vis-a-vis the law. The law system was a conditional-based system of acceptance. The law demanded that one adhere to a specific code of conduct, that one adheres to the various ordinances and regulations and commands and statutes that God gave. And part of that covenant agreement would provide a reward when one was obedient. However, if one was disobedient, the Lord did warn that the individual could face punishment or cursing. So the idea in that type of a relationship simply means that if you don't live up, if you don't abide, if you don't maintain, if you don't hold on, if you don't keep straight, watch out, because potentially God might punish you. Now, granted, if you hold on and keep straight and maintain and keep right, you potentially could receive a blessing. Today, in the dispensation of the grace of Almighty God, that is not the type of relationship that we have with Almighty God. We are never motivated by that carrot on the stick type of system. Rather, grace teaches that we are already fully blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. And because of that, we don't serve God to get anything. We serve God because we already have everything. You see the difference? We don't serve to get something. We serve because we have something. And in keeping with that grace principle, we learn here in verse 24 that the apostle of the Gentiles, he did something with the Corinthians to reaffirm this particular principle that God expected the Corinthians to live in light of their identity, to live in light of their sonship status. And it's remarkable what the Apostle Paul has to say. And what he says is verse 24. Not for that we have dominion over your faith. Now, why does Paul say that? Number one, keep this in mind. This is a rebuke. There is, as always at Corinth, and that's kind of unfair to say that, the Corinthians have a history of problems, error, carnality. And so Paul has to deal harshly. Paul has, this is the third letter he's written. He's prepared to visit a third time. And he is now going to explain why he chose not to immediately leave Ephesus and meet with the Corinthian saints. He does it as a way of pressing upon them their need to grow up, their need not to depend on who he is, not to acquiesce to human authority. And sadly, what do people tend to do? They tend to acquiesce to human authority. The hallmark characteristic of the religious institution is to have an individual who exercises authority and, as Paul calls it, dominion over the people. That is a violation of that intimate relationship that our Heavenly Father seeks and desires from each and every one of us. Not even Paul would step over that line and exercise undue authority. Now there's a fine line that Paul is walking. On the one hand, you have people there that questioned his authority. I mean, a number of verses. In fact, go over to chapter 12. If you go over to chapter 13, I'm sorry, especially in chapter 13, a number of times in this particular epistle, Paul has to defend his apostleship. And by the way, isn't it interesting that even today, in the dispensation of the grace of God, don't we find ourselves having to defend Paul's apostleship? I mean, you can speak to fundamental brothers in Christ, and I've dealt with some of them who would actually make the claim that Paul was not the legitimate replacement that Paul should have been the legitimate replacement for Judas, and that Matthias was not the legitimate replacement for Judas. And that's a shame, because believing that kind of teaching causes tremendous problems when handling God's word. We have to defend Paul's apostleship because Paul defends his unique apostleship. Notice in chapter 13 and verse 3, since ye seek a proof of Christ, what? Speaking in me. You know what's going on there at Corinth? They're beginning to question his office. Who is this Paul? And the problem at Corinth is they applied human wisdom and human standards in order to ascertain whether Paul could really legitimately be a man sent from Almighty God. So there was a pocket there that doubted, they questioned, they had a rough time with the claims that Paul was making. So that we find in 2 Corinthians a number of times where Paul has to defend his apostleship. So there's a fine line that Paul's walking. On the one hand, there is a group that questioned his role as God's spokesman. They questioned his apostleship. They sought proof that Christ sent him. But on the other hand, you have an element at Corinth that would tend to fall victim to the personality cult. Remember what happened in 1 Corinthians when Paul writes the first letter to the Corinthians? Go to chapter 1 real quickly. I think it would do us well to just get a feel for one of the problems there at Corinth. And by the way, there was a number of problems at Corinth, but one of the problems that Paul had to address and why it is he says, I'm not going to have dominion over you. I am not going to do what is viewed as the right thing to do, because it will be a violation of one's relationship with God. And that's a fascinating lesson for us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 1, you do recall what was going on, for example, in verse 12. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I am of Paul, and I of Apollos, and I of Cephas, and I of Christ. Do you see the core problem here? You had some that would gravitate to, of course, Paul, but some would gravitate to Apollos, and some to Cephas, and some to the Lord Jesus Christ. So what does Paul say in verse 13? Is Christ what? Divided? Now understand, when Paul writes 1 Corinthians, the first four chapters, human wisdom, human wisdom, human wisdom. Paul, he's rebuking the Corinthians because they were aligning themselves with the wisdom of this world. And the wisdom of this world would gravitate toward certain individuals. So that is a problem inherent here at the church. Now go over to chapter 3. And notice there in verse 5, chapter 3, verse 5. Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believed, even as the Lord gave to every man? Chapter 4, notice chapter 4 and verse 5. Chapter 4, verse 6. And these things, brethren, I have in a figure transferred to myself and to Apollos for your sakes, that ye might learn in us not to think of men above that which is what? Now this is important. You know why Paul says, I'm not going to Corinth? As we'll see there in 2 Corinthians. He is forcing them to believe what's written. So just keep that in mind. The end of verse 6, that ye might learn in us not to think of men above that which is written, that no one of you be puffed up for one against another. For who maketh thee to differ from another? And what hast thou that thou didst not receive? Now if thou didst receive it, why dost thou glory as if thou hast not received it? Paul's rebuking this idea. Go to chapter 11, and notice in chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians. Chapter 11, verse Corinthians. And verse 20. Chapter 11, verse 20. Oh, that's not the verse. I apologize. Oh, well. Anyway, go to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. The point is this. What Paul is dealing with are a group of people that sadly had a desire at times among some to hold individuals up in higher esteem than they should have, viewing men as more authoritative than what is written. So when we come to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, we see Paul actually reaffirming the need for the Corinthians to subject themselves to the authority of the written word and not to the personality, Paul. So if we understand that Paul is rebuking, he is admonishing, he is correcting, he is reproving the conduct there at Corinth. Now this is what's going on. What exactly is happening that would have caused Paul to say, I don't want to have dominion over you? Now, in the context, and we're not going to go through the entire context, but actually it begins up there, if you notice, there in verse 16. Notice verse 16. Well, actually, read verse 15, okay. Let's read verse 15. And in this confidence I was minded to come unto you before, that ye might have a second benefit, and to pass by you into Macedonia, and to come again out of Macedonia unto you, and of you to be brought on my way toward Judea. When I therefore was thus minded, did I use lightness? Or the things that I purpose, do I purpose according to the flesh, that with me there should be yea, yea, and nay, nay? Now what in the world's Paul talking about? Paul was supposed to leave Ephesus and travel directly to Corinth. He didn't do that. So now Paul is being challenged. Why, Paul, did you not come and travel meeting with the Corinthians? Why didn't you come to address some of the prevailing issues and problems there plaguing the Corinthians? So Paul now, he's going to provide an explanation as to why he did not immediately travel. So guess what they're now accusing Paul of? Notice there in verse 17. When I therefore was thus minded, did I use lightness or the things that I purpose? Do I purpose according to the, what is that? The flesh? There we go. The element that criticized Paul. Paul, you said you were going to come. Paul, you promised you were going to come. Paul, you didn't come. So guess what they did? They used that as evidence against Paul that Paul was fickle, that Paul was duplicitous, that Paul was a type of individual who was a flip-flopper, he was indecisive, he couldn't make up his mind, he didn't have conviction, he's a man you can't count on. They're questioning his integrity. Now notice at the end of verse 17 that there should be yea, yea, and what? Nay, nay. Now, you know what Paul's going to do for the next few verses? Again, it's a hard read, but bear with me. Verse 18, but as God is true, our word toward you was not yea and nay, for the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus and Timotheus, was not yea and nay, but in him was yea, for all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen. Now, wait a minute. What is this? Yea, yea, nay, nay, in him, yea. And you see this, yea, yea, nay, 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 yea, yea. Now, we're in the political season right now. And you know exactly how a politician operates. He'll meet with one group, and he'll say whatever it takes to appease and to win that particular group. What does he do when he goes to the next group? He'll say whatever it takes to win that group. And then he'll go over to that. The point is, they're accusing Paul. Yeah, Paul, when you're with that group, you say one thing. But when you're with another group, you say something else. But when you're with another group, you say, so, in other words, Paul, you have no backbone, you have no conviction, you're nothing but a wet noodle. And you're yay over here, but you're nay over there. In other words, Paul, we can't believe you. We can't count on you. They were using Paul's decision not to go to Corinth as evidence that, Paul, you're a man not to be trusted. You say one thing, but you mean something. You speak from both sides of the mouth. So what is Paul doing? He is going to do a couple of things here. Number one, he is going to demonstrate that, this is a teachable moment, talking about the political season. This is a teachable moment. You're questioning my integrity? You're thinking that I'm just speaking out of both sides of my mouth? Paul is actually going to explain why he didn't immediately go to Corinth. Look at verse 23 of chapter 1. Moreover, I call God for a record upon my soul that to spare you, I came not as yet unto Corinth. Huh. Could Paul have immediately traveled from Ephesus to Corinth and deal with the problems? Could he have done that? Could have. But what does Paul say? I didn't. Why? Because I wanted to spare you. Look over there at chapter 2, verse 1. But I determined this with myself, that I would not come again to you in heaviness. By the way, read verse 1 very carefully. But I determined this with myself. You know what Paul's doing right here? He is exercising his free will. You understand what Paul, and we're going to elaborate in just a moment here. Was this God's decision for Paul not to go? Was it God's decision for Paul to do that? Was it God's, you know what Paul is doing? I'm making the decision here. And I determined in myself that I am not going to come to you, how? In heaviness. We'll see why Paul has to say it like that. Go to chapter 12, verse 14. Chapter 12, verse 14. You know, it's easy. Certainly it was easy for the Corinthians to question Paul and to ascribe some agenda and false motives. And there are going to be times where you perhaps are going to be accused of having some sort of an agenda or false motives. And perhaps maybe, you know, why can't you make up your mind, so on and so forth. In chapter 12, verse 14, behold, the third time I am ready to come to you. Now think about that. How many times is Paul expected to drop everything that he's doing and to rush to the aid of an assembly to correct and to solve and to deal with all of their problems? Let me ask you this question. If the Apostle Paul walked into this room right now, would he say anything to us that hasn't already been said? In other words, do we need Paul to take care of our problems here? Do we need Paul to take care of our individual personal problems in life? Do we need Jesus Christ? If the Lord Jesus Christ were, and obviously this is all theoretical, if the Lord Jesus himself were to walk into the, do we need Jesus Christ himself personally to help us in the details of our life? Absolutely not. The Lord Jesus would not say anything to you right now if he walked into this room than he hasn't already said to us. And we'll see some verses that will demonstrate that. You know what's going on at Corinth? Paul, in our desperate hour, in our desperate need, where were you? You failed us. You let us down. We need to understand, God never designed our growth. He never intended our maturation, the design for spiritual edification and spiritual growth and so forth to be dependent on the authority of personalities. We do not acquiesce to human authority. We have to learn that our edification rests and is firmly fixed on God's authoritative word. And Paul is going to, he chooses not to go to force the Corinthians to learn to be dependent upon that which is written. They don't need Paul. Now, that's not to say Paul didn't care. Going back to chapter 12, verse 14, behold, the third time I'm ready to come to you, and I will not be burdensome to you, for I seek not yours, but you. Now, you see why he says burdensome? Guess what happened the first two times he went to Corinth? Was it a pretty sight? You know what happened the two previous visits at Corinth? Paul had to rebuke. He had to correct. He had to reprove. You know that there were tears. There was some heartache. There was some pain. Paul had to straighten some things out, and it hurt Paul. Paul, you know, don't picture Paul as an individual who enjoyed coming down on an erring brother. You think he wasn't touched when he informed the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that you have to let that brother, you got to leave him for the destruction of the flesh? You hand him over to the Satan for the destruction of the flesh? You think that didn't hurt Paul? Paul actually is going to talk about that in the second letter, okay? Because he experienced anguish. It affected him. It touched him in a very deep and personal way. Look there at chapter 13, verse 1. Chapter 13, verse 1. This is the third time I am coming to you. In the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. I told you before and foretell you as if I were present the second time, and being absent now, I write to them which hitherto have sinned, and to all other that if I come again, I will not what? This is what Paul is saying. I went the first time to straighten up the problems, and you're still having issues. I came the second time to straighten out the problems, and guess what? They're still having issues. And in the interim, he writes two letters. So now he says, if I come a third time, I'm not going to spare a third time. You heard the adage, right? Three strikes and what? Listen. Paul is tired of having to return and to have to deal with the problems that they should have corrected if they were walking by faith. And Paul, by way of rebuke, so go back to 2 Corinthians chapter 1, go back to chapter 1. Now we understand why Paul writes what he writes. He says there, again, in chapter 1, verse 23, moreover, I call God for a record upon my soul that to spare you, isn't that interesting? That to spare you. He didn't want to have to rehash all of this. It was starting to wear on him. Somebody rightly has described 2 Corinthians as the impassioned self-defense of a wounded spirit to erring and disobedient children. Paul's had enough. It was taking a toll on him. Fightings without, fears within, he says. Listen, I'm tired of this. So he says, I didn't come because I don't want to be there to just stir up that pot anymore. And more importantly, the Corinthians don't need him any more than you or I need the human intervention of the Apostle Paul right now. We don't need that. Why? Because God has given us the sufficiency of his word. And you know what the problem at Corinth was? They just thought, give Paul a call, dial 911, and he'll be there to fix it up. That is an edification. Edification is not having to run to somebody and expecting somebody else to fix up your problems. Edification has nothing to do with leaning on someone and expecting them to solve your ills, to deal with the problems, to lead the way. God says, I'm the one that wants to do that. And how does he do it? He does it by way of personal, individual edification. We all stand accountable to him. You know what Paul is saying? You're not accountable to me. I'm going to leave me alone. That's what Paul is saying. Leave me alone. Because what you're doing is you're bringing offense to the effectual working of God's word that is expected to do the job. I mean, for end of verse, again, verse 23, moreover, I call thee for a record, God for a record upon my soul, that to spare you, I came not as yet to Corinth. Verse 24, not for that we have dominion over your faith. You see, that's a rebuke. I'm not going to have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy, for by faith ye what? Stand. They're not doing it. That's why Paul says what he says. You see, we need to understand. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. There is, sadly, this lack of appreciation regarding the work of God's word in each and every one of our lives. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And notice there in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. 2 Timothy chapter 3. Verse 16, and look what he says. Verse 16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, truly furnished unto all good works. We don't need Paul, and we don't need the Lord Jesus Christ to walk into this room and tell us anything. Why? Because the living word hath given to us his written word. And it's the written word, the scriptures, that truly furnish each and every one of us unto all good works. So go back to 2 Corinthians. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 2 now, Paul's going to remind them, look, I wrote to you already. In 2 Corinthians chapter 2, notice there in verse 3, 2 Corinthians 2, verse 3, and I wrote this same unto you, lest when I come, I should have sorrow from them whom I ought to rejoice. Did you catch that? Verse 3, I wrote this same unto you. I've already written about this. Study it. Study it as God's word. Study it as the effectual working of truth. Don't rely on me. Lest when I come, I should have sorrow from them of whom I ought to rejoice. But you see, Paul wanted to go back the third time and rejoice with the Corinthians that the work of Scripture did its job. That's why he was reluctant. He's writing a third time. And hopefully the third letter is going to stick. Of whom I ought to rejoice, having confidence in you all, that my joy is the joy of you all. Verse 4, for out of much affliction and anguish of heart, I wrote unto you with many tears. Wow. Because Paul understood the problems. You know, it's like a child. Sometimes they got to learn by trial and error, you know? And Paul, it's Paul, in effect, he's saying, I'm writing this to you again, and I'm writing it with tears. Can you envision that letter with water spots, teardrops splashing on the letter? The ink's probably smudged just a little bit. I wrote with many tears, not that ye should be grieved, but that ye might know the love which I have more abundantly unto you. Paul is providing corrective doctrine. The problem is lack of faith in what Paul is writing to them. Ye stand by faith. We never stand based upon the authority of a human figure. Never. That's a violation of the relationship that we have with our Father. It's the Father and what He personally is teaching us through His Word. That is where we are supposed to stand. In chapter 7, go to chapter 7, verse 12. Chapter 7, verse 12. Wherefore, though I wrote unto you, I did it not for his cause that had done this wrong, nor for his cause that suffered wrong, but that our care for you in the sight of God might appear unto you. You see what Paul's trying to say? Listen, Paul's sort of a bad guy. He's got to straighten it out. But he wants them to understand he genuinely loves them. The corrective doctrine isn't merely to condemn, to belittle. It isn't for the purpose of making anyone small. Paul does it because he does care. He loves them. He values them. So he leaves the Corinthians to the Word of God. Now there's one other point. Go back to chapter 1. There's something else that Paul is going to press here, and we're not going to deal with this. It's kind of interesting. If you notice in chapter 1, the decision, before Paul provides the explanation as to why he didn't come, he didn't travel back to Corinth, it's rather interesting when he says what he says in verse 21. You ever notice chapter 1, verse 21? Now he which establisheth us with you in Christ hath anointed us, is God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. You ever wonder why Paul says that? Why does Paul say, listen, I didn't make the decision by the flesh. I did purpose, but you know, I changed my mind. And you know why I changed my mind? Because Paul is saying, I'm exercising my right to change my mind. That's why in verse 21, now he which establishes us with you in Christ and hath anointed us is God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. Paul said, well, listen, I'm established in the doctrine. Now, maybe the Corinthians aren't fully established. Paul talks about how to be established, doesn't he? In Romans 16, he talks about how one is established in the word of truth. In Colossians, he talks about being established in the faith. And you know what Paul is saying? He is saying that because he is established in the doctrine, he's established in the faith. Guess what he's able to do now? He's able to order his life. He is able now to prioritize his life in such a way that he can make willful choices unto the glory of God. He can prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of Almighty God. It's by edification. So there's really a subtle thing that Paul is doing here. He's telling us the proper mind in arriving at the decision. How do you arrive at the decisions you make? How do I arrive at the decisions I make? Is it because somebody tells me how to do it? You see, Paul says, I'm not going to have dominion over you. Do you live your life because somebody tells you how to do it? Or do I live my life because I'm established? Because I'm anointed? Because I've got the earnest of the Spirit in my heart? Paul's not talking about salvation. He's talking about the Spirit whereby we cry, Abba, Father. We actually learn how Paul came to make that decision. He exercised his free will in accordance to the edification and the establishment that he has been enjoying. But one other thing, and we're going to stop. Here's another reason why Paul willfully chose not to travel to Corinth. He wants them to trust in the written word of God. He wants them to respond positively to the previous letters that he's written. Now, one of them is, of course, Scripture, 1 Corinthians. And he's disappointed that they did not respond positively to the information in that epistle. And he's not just going to drop what he's doing and put the fire out. It's time for them to grow up. But there is also another reason why Paul refused to travel right away. When he in verse 24 says, not for that we have dominion over your faith, but are helpers of your joy. He's doing something that is contrary to what the religious system is doing, a religious system that the Corinthians were welcoming. Quickly go to chapter 11. You see, Paul deliberately will not do what the professionals are doing out there, if you will. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, he actually describes a group of men that actually did infiltrate the church at Corinth. And guess what they did? They exercised dominion over the Corinthians. What is the easiest, quickest way to exercise dominion over a group of people in a church? It's called the law. It's called the bondage system of the law. And all one has to do is convince the believer that if you truly love God, if you truly want to be spiritual, you have to adhere to that Bible system called the law program. And if you can get people to operate under the law, guess where you've got them? You now become the authority where you hold that individual accountable and responsible to their obedience or lack thereof to that system of the law. That's exactly what happened at Corinth. Chapter 11, of course, Paul describes in verse 13 the false apostles, the deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. Verse 14, and no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness. Okay? So they can call themselves the apostles of Christ. Doesn't make it so. But they're preaching righteousness. They're preaching self-righteousness. With that, drop down and notice verse 19. For ye suffer fools gladly, seeing you yourselves are wise. For ye suffer if a man bring you into bondage, if a man devour you, if a man take of you, if a man exalt himself, if a man smite you on the face. Does that sound like the description of an individual exercising dominion? I mean, coming around and putting you under bondage and devouring you, that actually takes us back to Galatians chapter 5. You know what the law does? The law will lead a believer to bite and devour one another. Oh, yeah. You know what the law does? The law sets these standards and expectations, and God forbid that you aren't abiding by those standards and expectations of the law. And so Paul, he rips the Galatians to shred because they wanted to be back under that system of bondage, and they're biting and devouring one another. These men, what are they doing? They're taking from them. You know how one can exercise dominion over your pocketbook? How can a man exercise dominion over your purse or over your wallet? If you love God, you're going to tithe, right? And there you go again. You just throw that yoke, that burden called the law, and you use the law system to compel people to give. Paul says, they're taking from you. Isn't that interesting? Because God says, if any man wants to give, let him give willingly and how? Cheerfully. The Lord loveth what? A cheerful. God doesn't take anybody's money. God, you know what? We should never say we're going to take the offering. Does that sound like grace? Taking an offering? Taking a collection? No, it's your opportunity to give. See, that's quite different. So what do these people do? They're going to take from you. If a man exalt himself, that is, they desire the preeminence. They want to have the name. They want to have the reputation. They want to have the notoriety. They want to have the preeminence. You know, that, you see, that's what a religion does, right? If a man smite you on the face, There is no more telling feature of one having dominion when they can now begin to abuse you. Now, whether or not they were literally smiting them on the eye, perhaps it's figurative. We know something about the face being the being significant in regards to identity and so forth. I don't know if it's literal or if it's figurative, but we do know something about smiting someone on the face. You're defrauding. You're abusing. You're manipulating. You're controlling. Verse 21, I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, when whereinsoever any is bold, I speak foolishly, I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they the ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. You know how Paul proves his apostleship? Verse 24, I am more, in labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in deaths often. And now he begins to list a whole litany of atrocities that were committed against him as proof of his love for the Corinthian saints. Paul never sought to exact anything, to take anything, to manipulate the Corinthian saints. He wanted to be a helper. He wanted to come along and lead the Corinthians to that understanding of who they are in Christ, free, liberated, blessed, loved, adored, appreciated. And he wanted the Corinthians to respond positively to the written instruction that he gave them. And he wanted to teach them, don't rely on human authority, because people will fail most of the time. God's word will never fail. Father, we do thank you for your love, for your goodness, your grace. We thank you especially for your word and how it is we can come to it with believing hearts, hearts of faith, so that we can stand by faith. We pray, Lord, that we would learn how it is you seek from us that level of intimacy and familiarity where we now commune with you, making decisions, leading a life that is based upon the conviction that your word personally brings to our inner man. We thank you, Lord, that your word can have that place in our lives. We thank you, Lord, that we do have one another to help one another, not for the purpose of belittling or scolding, but rather to be helpers of each other's joy, the joy that comes as we walk by faith, the joy that comes as we see all of the riches that are ours in the person of our Savior. We thank you for the sufficiency of your grace. We thank you for the sufficiency of your word. And may our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be exalted through it all. And it is in his name that we pray. Amen.